This is the iBUG Buzz call for September the 25th, 2023, episode number 602. And I'm Marie, going to be facilitating along with Sandhya. And we welcome everybody. This is a open forum call that is dedicated to iOS, and that includes the iPhone, the iPad, the iPod Touch, the Apple Watch, and the Apple TV. Also, we will include any peripherals that you use, such as headsets and keyboards, as well as the apps that we use. And our main purpose for this call is to make you more comfortable and more knowledgeable with the accessibility features included in all Apple products. We welcome you all, whether you're here live or if you're listening to this on a later recording or a podcast.
I'll go ahead and get started by telling you about some of the upcoming iBUG events for this week. This week, like I said, for the next 2 hours, we'll have the iBUG Buzz. We'll have our big reveal at the midpoint. Then tomorrow we have two events. Okay, all times are central, and everything is on Zoom unless specified otherwise. So tomorrow we have Clubhouse, iBUG Mini Buzz from 5 to 6. Then in the evening we have Mac and Talk from 7 to 8:30. Then on Thursday we have It's iBUG's Life, taking care of business relating to all kinds of organizational tips and tricks. So we hope you will come for that. Then on Friday we'll have our movie 8 p.m. social time at 7:15, and discussion and trivia to follow. We had our iBUG Apple workshop this past Saturday, where we discussed the most recent developments in iOS 17. Herbie and Greg and I did a little bit of a panel discussion, and that episode will be posted very soon. So, we're going to open it up, and we'd like for you to say who you are, where you're from, and if it's your first time here. Okay.
You live in Herbie in
Okay.
Houston.
All right, keep going. Who else?
This is
Mark in
Pete in Florida.
Montreal.
All right, welcome. Hang on.
Mark in
Gary in
Montreal.
Austin.
Welcome. Marie, are you back? Okay. Sandhya, I'm
Angelo in
here.
Ottawa.
Thanks, I'm Michigan.
Welcome.
Thank you.
Chanel in Houston.
Welcome, Chanel.
Jeanette
Angelo in
here.
Ottawa.
Jeanette and Angelo?
Yep.
Janet and
Janet in
Angelo.
Colorado.
Sorry. Yes, welcome
Mark in
both of you.
Montreal, down the road from Angelo, just a piece.
Hi, Mark.
I'm
Gary in
Mishka in
Austin.
Houston for the first time.
Vincent in New Jersey.
Okay, Benson, and who was that was new?
Mishka, I'm in
Mishka,
Houston.
welcome,
Yes, ma'am.
and how did you hear about iBug?
She teaches me the cane. She told me about it because
Oh,
I
your
was trying to learn
mobility
something.
trainer.
Over there you go. I have so much going. Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, well, good. What kind of Apple device did you use?
I have the iPhone 14 Pro Max.
All right. Okay, next.
Gary.
Hi, Gary.
Hey, Marie.
Jody from Montreal.
Bridget.
Hello from
Bridget from
Montreal.
Atlanta.
Hi, Bridget.
Ed from
Liz
Georgetown, Ontario.
Portland. Hello, Ed, and who was that else?
Liz.
Hi, Liz.
This is Dee in Southern Illinois.
Hello, Miss D. Hello.
Greg in Texas.
Hi, Greg.
Dan, Southern California.
Hello, Dan. Welcome.
Hi, Nancy from Bend.
Welcome, Nancy.
Desi
Good
from
old Bend,
Franklin,
Oregon.
Tennessee.
I'm sorry, who's from Tennessee?
Desi from Franklin,
Oh, hi,
Tennessee.
Desi.
Hi.
Brad, I'm in Dallas.
Hello, Mr. Brad.
Elizabeth from Newfoundland, Canada.
Hello, Elizabeth.
Marcia, Daytona Beach.
Marcia from...
Jody from New Hampshire.
Hi, Jody.
Charles from Houston.
No, from Houston.
Doug in Houston.
Another Houston.
Deb from Kansas.
Hello, Deb.
Marvin in Chicago.
Is that Marvin?
Correct.
Welcome. Okay, we got anybody else?
Ray from Maine.
Ray?
Yes.
Any other newbies? Okay.
Kimberly from Hamilton.
Oh, hi, Kimberly. Anybody else? Okay, if not, how about our first question? See if you can stump the experts or supposed experts.
Well, I'm the new one, Mishka, and my trainer, she uses the, what do you call it, voiceover. And so she was showing me how to use it, but she's totally blind, so we couldn't really get it. But whenever I use voiceover, my phone reads everything, but it doesn't allow me to unlock it. And so we did, we called Apple Access, and it was no help. So she told me about this group, and, you know, I've been in a Facebook group asking questions.
Mm-hmm. Well, this group is all about using voiceover. Almost everybody on this call, all of our questions and answers are pertaining to the use of the phone with voiceover, because awesome. Most of us are either totally blind or partially blind.
Okay.
Anyway, and also when you want to speak, if you would call your name and wait to be recognized, please.
Sorry. Okay.
This is Sandhya.
Go ahead.
I think Mishka was asking how to unlock the phone because when she turned on voiceover, she was having trouble.
This is Deb.
Go ahead, Deb.
She said she had a 14 Pro, I think, Pro Max, uh-huh. maybe.
Uh-huh.
To unlock the phone, first of all, you push the side button that's on the right side, and then you just slide your finger or your thumb up from the middle up to where you feel the first vibration if you've got that turned on. But it's about halfway up, and that should unlock your phone. It might ask you for a passcode or face ID if you have that set up.
Yes, ma'am. I do have it set up, and we tried the sliding up with Apple Access. That's what they told me to do, too, and it didn't work. So, I know how to unlock it. Normally, it just you just put my face on it, and it unlocks, but it's not doing that when I have voiceover on. But any other time, it unlocks fine.
Did Brad? They tell you to?
Go ahead, Brad.
Well, let her finish. She was still talking.
Deb, did you have some more explanation?
I was just going to say that, have you tried, I'm sure if you were talking to Apple's accessibility, they told you to turn your phone off and on and maybe do a hard reset on it. Maybe that would fix it.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, Brad.
Yeah, if you got voiceover turned on, first thing you should do, like we said, is when you put your finger down near the bottom of the screen, you should hear one pop. And then you should slide it up to the second pop, and then you're going to let go. If you have Face ID turned on, just simply pressing the side button to wake it up, as Deb said, and then pointing the phone at your face, it should just instantly unlock. You did say you have Face ID enabled, correct?
Yes, sir. And that's what I did. So I can see the screen and it's reading everything that's on the screen, but it only reads what's there. So I had Gmail coming. I had other notifications.
Okay. Hang on. When you say the screen, we're trying to get through the lock screen. So when you unlock it and have it facing your face and you look at it,
mm-hmm.
does it immediately unlock and go to the home screen?
No, sir.
Okay. It should, and voiceover should not have any effect on that one way or the other, because, and then you should be on the lock screen. And once it unlocks, and you'll hear a little pop when it unlocks, I hear a little sound on mine. And then you want to take your finger at the bottom, you'll hear a pop, and then you'll slide it up to the, to you, till you hear another pop, and then you'll let go. Now, if it's not unlocked, it's then going to prompt you for your passcode. And what do you got, a 4-digit or a 6-digit passcode?
4, yes, sir.
Okay. You should, you are you able to see a little bit? So you probably see there's a keypad there. So you put your finger on the first number, it'll speak it. But then you have to do a one-finger double tap to, you know, initiate the fact, the selection of that number. Okay. So let's say your first number is 0. You're going to put your finger on the 0. You're going to hear voiceover say 0. Then you're going to do a double tap, and it can be anywhere on the screen. It doesn't even have to be on that 0. And then you go pick your second number, say number 1. You'll hear it say 1. And then you'll do a double tap anywhere on the screen, and voiceover will repeat 1. And then you'll do the same thing for your remaining numbers. And once you've successfully typed in all 4 numbers, it just goes to your home screen. It makes a little sound, another little sound effect, and it will go to your home screen, and you're there. And if it's just reading them all, sometimes it may just start reading everything on the screen. You can always put 2 fingers on this, touch the screen with 2 fingers, and that'll stop that. Now, there's a whole lot to learn about voiceover, but hopefully that'll just get you unlocked and get you in there, and then you can start exploring more.
Yes, new question, please.
Ray from Maine.
Go ahead, Ray.
Okay, very simple question. How do I turn my phone on after it's off?
Okay, somebody tell him how to turn that phone on.
Jerry. What type of phone do you have?
It's an iPhone 10, I think.
Does it have a side button or a fingerprint either, the touch button on the screen?
It has a button on the side. It used to be that I just pressed that button and held it for about 4 or 5 seconds, and the phone came on.
That's still the same.
The only way to get this phone to come on is for me to plug it in the charger.
It should still be the same. Hold the side button in for 4 or 5 seconds, and it should turn on automatically. It takes a bit. It doesn't turn on right a bit. The Apple will appear, and you still have to wait a little before you can put in your passcode.
I don't ever have to put a passcode in. I don't use that.
Okay. Well, you have to put in, holding the side button for several seconds, and then let go, and it'll take a little bit before it turns on. It doesn't turn on like right away. It takes, I don't know exactly how long. But
maybe I'm just impatient. Okay, thank you.
This is Vincent.
Jody.
Sorry. Go ahead, Jody.
I'm sorry, Vincent and then Jody.
No, go ahead, Vincent.
Okay, what I was going to say is that I have had similar issues with my phone, and it's an SE 2022. And many times it's unresponsive. I've had it. In fact, yesterday I had my wife's phone on the charger, and when I was trying to download the latest update, and there was no response whatsoever. It did not react by pushing the button. There was no reaction. The phone didn't come off at all. So what I have done in the past is I either plug it or unplug it. And it will eventually come back up. And this time around, I just removed it from the magnetic charger, and the screen came back on, and I was able to log in. But that's something that has been happening. Well, more recently with the latest update, but I have had that issue before. And I have found no way of, nothing. It works most of the times, but sometimes I have to, plugging it and unplugging it. And sometimes what I have to do is I have to restart the phone, even though I never turned it off, even if it was charged, even if it has a sufficient charge in there, it doesn't react until I attempt to, sort of reset it. And it comes back on, but it's something that has been happening on and off, not all the time, but it is, I guess, some form of a bug that hasn't been fixed.
Hey, Jody.
I was going to say the same thing, and that you realize how totally addicted we are to our phones when we can't get it to come back. It's like no. Yeah, I've had the same thing happen.
Okay, do we have another question?
This is John with a question.
Okay, John.
I'm using version 17, and I use Siri to set a timer. And before version 17, I could set somewhere, and I don't remember where it was, the sound that would be played for the timer. But for under 17, I can't find where to set the Siri timer. The individual timers under clock have an individual setting, but I have somehow lost the ability to set the timer sound under version 17. And if anybody knows, I'd appreciate it. Thank you.
This is Jody.
Go ahead, John.
Hi, Jody.
Yes, hi, John. You want to go to settings and then go to sounds. And you should be able to select the sound you want there for the alarms and the timers and that sort of thing. And you might even check your volume, make sure your volume's up. It's great to hear you.
Nice to get an answer. Thank you.
Just sure. A little clarification, John, are you not hearing a timer alert at all?
No, I'm hearing one, but it's something that that's not very pleasing.
Okay. And all right.
I thought, Jody, that I had gone to settings, but I'll try it again. I couldn't find a timer setting in there under the new version.
This is Jody. It might not say timer specifically, but it will say alerts and that sort of thing. So
okay,
and then you can select it there.
Great, thank you,
Mark in Montreal.
Okay, go ahead, Mark, and then we'll go on.
There is a bug in iOS 17 under sounds and haptics. I don't know if it has to do with because of all the new ringtones in iOS 17 or what the heck it is. But if you go to set your ringtones and have favorite ringtones, you're fine. If it's text tones or something else, all your preset ringtones or whatever tones you may want may not be in the other options. And it's a bug in 17. Hopefully they'll fix it. It wasn't fixed in iOS 17.01 release. That was just a security update and for some fixes, but you might have to wait for subsequent update. I know the weather app also loses focus, the Apple weather app, and that one hasn't been fixed, but there is a definite issue with ringtones for text tones and other options in sounds and haptics that are not coming up at the moment.
Thank you.
Okay, new question. Let's keep them rolling, folks.
Jerry. Yeah, I just have a comment. If anybody else notices it, it's a bug in iOS 17 in Mail when opening a picture that is an attachment, direct touch will come on. Like you can't get out of the pitch. Even if there's a done button there, I double tap on it. It will not go back into the email itself. It stays in the picture and you can't get out of it. The only way you can is closing the mail app and reopening it again. I was on with Apple today. I did a diagnostics and the engineer said it was a known bug. So just in case somebody else has that problem,
okay,
they do know about it.
Thanks for that, Jerry. In case anybody else runs into it, we'll know that it is a bug and it's been reported already. So, all right, next question.
This is Vincent.
Go ahead, Vincent.
I noticed a similar issue using my iPad. It's updated to the latest update, 17.1 or 2, whatever it is. And I accessed a PDF that was part of an email. And I was able, it read me absolutely everything, all the information that wasn't there. But for my life, I could not find any button to close it, to go back to the original email where it came from. So what I had to do was to go to the app switcher and close. There it indicated that email was open. I closed the email, and then when I opened it again, I was back in the email screen, but I could not get out of the PDF screen. I looked everywhere in the screen, and there was no button to go back to Gmail. So I wonder if I'm doing something wrong or if it's similar to what Jerry was just mentioning.
Jerry.
Yes, Jerry.
I did have the done button on the top left, but even when tapping on it, all it said was, I'm not sure exactly 100% how it's called, direct touch area, yeah. Well, you need direct touch for certain games or whatever. And that is what it said. Even if I double tapped on the done button, the share button was on the bottom, the markup button. I actually never tried to press them, but the done button, double tapping on it, nothing happened. Like I said, I did a screen recording and sent it to Apple, but they are aware of it. The only way I could get out of it is close the mail app, open it back up, and then it was in that same email, but the attachment was not open.
Jerry, since it said something about direct touch, you try going into the rotor and seeing if you could turn off direct touch and then maybe the done button would work. And who was that? Was that
D?
Go ahead.
Okay. Yeah, I just have a suggestion. I don't know if it would work in that situation, but a lot of times if you do the two-finger scrub, that will back you off of a screen and go back to where you were prior to that.
This is Chanel.
Go ahead, Chanel.
So the other day when I was looking at rotor settings and I verified it's there again, there's something called direct touch apps. And so if you go into it, maybe you can double tap on the mail app to disable direct touch from ever coming up in that app. I'm guessing how that feature works. I'm not sure, but you go to VoiceOver and then Rotor, and then you'll see it. It's called Direct Touch Apps. So Jerry. Hopefully that is helpful.
Okay, Jerry.
Yeah, I don't have Direct Touch turned on. That's the funny part about it. I have it turned off.
It sounded like it might be coming on automatically when you go into that picture because it did mention something. About yeah,
that's area. Possible. I'll look at that. And I just have one more quick. Now when you go into accessibility and verbosity, check it out. There's a lot more new settings, a lot more different settings in there that there were up till now in iOS 17. That's accessibility, VoiceOver, verbosity. There's quite a few more settings in there to play with.
I know. I've been in there myself, so I know you're correct. Okay, do we have a new question? It's time to move on.
This is David.
David, go ahead.
Yeah, I was just going to clarify about that, changing the tone for your timer. You actually have to go into the clock app and under the timers tab, and then it'll have your current tone will be there. There'll be a button.
Go ahead.
Yeah, so if you double tap on that button where it announces what your tone is, then it'll give you first it gives you the new ones, which some people may not be in favor of, but you can go down to classic. There's a classic button which will take you to the older ones that we've known for years, and you can kind of scroll through those and find the one that you like. But on the sounds and haptics, it doesn't let you set the tones for the alarms or timers because you're only done in the clock app.
So it's in the clock app. Okay, thank you, David. All right, new question.
This is Ed.
Go ahead, Ed.
In emails, when I go into an email, I open the email, and when I'm finished with it, I toggle over and I hit move. And before, when I hit move, it would give me the first folder that I've sent that normally I've sent that email to. If it's a repeat name, it would let me double tap on that and it would send it to the file. But since the 17 update, it says, it just says when you hit move, it says new file, but it doesn't bring up the old location for the name in that email. And you have to toggle through all of your folders in order to get to it. Is there a setting to change that? Is that a change setting, or is that just something that's happened in emails?
Okay. Has anybody tried to move an email into a different folder in mail? I think 17 is so new. People are kind of unsure just yet of what to do with a lot of these things because there's a lot of little changes here and there.
Yeah, and it's always that that situation where you hit it and it automatically goes to the
usually defaults
to the name.
To
it's always been like that. Mm-hmm. Ever since I got my iPad or iPhone.
This is Greg.
But this is brand new with 17. Yeah.
Okay, go ahead, Greg.
Yeah, I'm running 17 and moved an email today, and it just brought up the standard list of where do you want to move it and inbox, and just brought up a list. And I just flicked right to the one I wanted and double tapped. That could just be some of the results vary by user and iPhone. I don't know. It worked for me today.
This is Sarah.
Go ahead.
Sorry, were you finished, Greg?
Yes.
Okay. I also have been moving emails, and I think it may be the spatial placement of it may have moved. So if you're using your phone, sometimes you can move your finger around until you find where the list is. Or you can just keep placing your finger in different places, or as Greg was saying, swipe to the right until you get there. But it's there. It's there. It's just spatially a little bit different.
This is Ed.
Go ahead, Ed.
Yeah, I have no problems finding the folder. What when I finish reading the email, before, if I hit the move, I hit move and hit the right button, it would go to the first choice, which would be the actual location that I'm looking for. If the name on the email is a repeat of what I have in the folder, it doesn't say go to new folder. It actually brings up the name of the folder that's in there. Like I don't have to look for it, and I don't have to toggle through all of the folders to get to it.
Just to clarify, Ed, and before it was going to a default folder that you normally do move messages.
Yeah,
too,
like it,
correct.
If I had a,
and it's not doing that now.
Yeah, if I had a an email, say from my wife, which I have a folder for, it would come up, and I would get an email from her. I would read it. I would hit move, and it would automatically, because her name is on the email that I'm getting, and her name is on the file, it would bring up that file, and I would just hit enter. But now you have to toggle through them all to get to it. So there's something different in there.
All right, let's keep going.
Okay.
Okay, next question.
This is Desi.
Go ahead, Desi.
This might be kind of one of those questions that is just, you know, phone specific or something, not really phone specific, but anyway, I have had my iPhone 14 Pro for just a couple of days over a year now, and I went in to check battery status today, and it says that my maximum capacity, not easy to say, is down to 93%. And I was wondering if I do use my phone a tremendous amount during every day. Even though I have an iPad and I have a Mac and I use those too, but it seems like I use my phone for more things. But I was wondering if a battery would normally go down for the maximum capacity that low within a year. Does that seem unusual? Or
Mark in Montreal?
Go ahead, Mark.
No, it's not unusual. After a year, year and a half, mine has gone down, not on this phone, but the previous phone I had. I'm running a 14 Pro at the moment, and my maximum capacity is currently at 91. Now, I will say that when it gets below 80, and if you choose, you still have the phone and don't want to upgrade your phone, I'm hoping by the time mine hits 80, that the 16s will be out, my contract will be up, and then I can go for a 16 Pro, and so it won't be a concern. But in my previous phone, I had the battery replaced under Apple Care because it was below 80%. Capacity, and they said once it gets below 80, bring it in and we'll replace the battery as long as you have Apple Care on it. Otherwise, you have to pay for it. And I think it was like slightly over $100 Canadian if you didn't have Apple Care on your phone to replace the battery. But below 80, they will replace it on Apple Care.
This is Desi. Thanks, Mark. Yeah, I was actually, I do have Apple Care, and if I get down that far on this phone before it's time to replace it, I probably will replace the battery. But no, I was just kind of, you know, I mean, like I said, it's kind of a subjective question because I suppose it depends a lot on how much you use your phone and all that kind of stuff. But I was surprised that it was already at 93% after just a year. So anyway, thanks. That really clarifies that for me. Anyway, thanks.
No problem. This is Shree.
Okay. Was that Shree? Go ahead.
I did read some articles about the 14 Pro and the battery, and there has been some reports that complained about the 14's batteries were actually draining faster than the other devices. But if you're at 92%, you had it for a year, you're probably doing pretty good.
Thanks, Shree.
Hey, we have another question.
Mishka.
Go ahead, Mishka. Is it okay. Mishka? Is that correct?
Yes, ma'am.
All right, thank you.
Okay, I'm in Houston, and I'm just wondering if perhaps there's a place where I can actually go that could walk me through the voiceover thing, because it's not working out for me.
This is Shree.
Go ahead, Shree.
Have you signed up for our mentor mentee program?
I wasn't familiar with it, no. Where do I go?
So basically, I'm sure, you know, maybe Sandhya can explain it to you better than I can, but we do have a service that we offer, a program where we do a one-on-one. It's not in face-to-face, but we do it over either through a phone or through Zoom, where we can show you how to use your phone. But you can go to the iBUG Today website, and there's a section for Mentor program to sign up.
Okay, I'll do that. Thank you.
By the way, that website is ibugtoday.org.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you.
All right. New question.
This is Terry.
Go ahead, Terry.
With just a follow-up. If you go to the website and you find that you aren't able to fill out the questionnaire, the application yourself, we can help you with that as well over the phone if you need that help for you or for anybody else that might be interested in signing up.
It's Kathy.
Yeah, this is Nate. One more thing.
Kathy, hold on.
I was going to say, it is free.
Yes, it's all free.
This is me.
Is that D? Okay, go ahead, D.
Okay. I may be totally wrong on this now because I was never lucky enough to live within 100 miles of an Apple store, okay? So y'all correct me if I'm wrong. But I thought if you bought your phone and you go to an Apple store, which you have one of those in Houston, if it's, you know, fairly new phone, they will help you get you started with the voiceover and things if you ask for one of their experts on voiceover. Do they still do that?
This is Sandhya.
Go ahead, Sandhya.
Yeah, if you go to the Highland Village store, they should be able to at least help you unlock your phone and some of the basics that you are asking about.
All right. Let's go ahead and go on.
Yeah, this is Greg.
Go ahead, Greg.
Yeah, one other suggestion for Mishka. There's an app, VO Starter, that will walk you through the voiceover gestures. It's a real good app for beginners.
I'll download it. Thank you again.
Okay, let's move on to a new subject.
Thomas in Colorado.
Go ahead, Thomas.
Just a quick question. For those that use iOS 17, have they fixed the screen curtain thing where voiceover turns off, comes back on? I'm done speaking. Thank you.
Anybody have an answer of the voiceover stopping speaking?
This is Sri.
Go ahead, Sri.
I've not had that experience.
Okay. Anybody else? This is Marie. I have had it, and I've still had it with my 13 Pro running 17. Maybe not as often. And generally now all I have to do is I'll just have Siri turn voiceover off and back on again, and it's talking. It's not lasting. Before, sometimes I had to actually restart the phone to get it talking again. But I have had it happen with 17, unfortunately.
This is Mark in Montreal.
Okay, Mark, go ahead.
I've had the issue where I've listened to an iMessage or something, and it used to be on phone calls back in 16, but since I've been running the beta and now the real 17, after an iMessage is played, and this is just one, I'm sure there's been other areas as well where voiceover has just totally gone, disappeared, mm-hmm. Not there. You could hear the clicks on the screen. And what I found as a workaround was, because I use a Bluetooth keyboard from time to time, turn on the Bluetooth keyboard and tap on your, if you have your caps lock key set up to do your flicking forward and whatnot, it's, forget what the voiceover command is, it's Tree or somebody help me out there, where you set up your caps lock key and you can do make it do things for voiceover. But if you lose your speech and tap like a mad hatter on your caps lock key, for some reason, your speech will come back.
Okay.
Just like tap on it 3, 4, 5 times and it'll come back on you. Mm-hmm. And it'll be fine.
Did I hear D? Would somebody else have a comment?
Janet from Colorado.
Go ahead, Janet.
I have where voiceover stops when I enter a Zoom call and I have to turn voiceover off and back on to get it to start talking again. I don't know why it's happening in Zoom, but it is. So I think it's a bug.
This is Terry.
Go ahead, Terry.
I'm still running iOS 16, and whenever I make a phone call with recent updates to it, I'm on a phone call, sometimes a FaceTime, whatever. I lose my speech the minute I disconnect the call, whichever it is, and I think that's even happened in Zoom, and I'm still in iOS 16. Mm-hmm. So it's a bug somewhere.
Mark in Montreal.
Okay, Mark.
When you upgrade to 17, Terry, that'll disappear on your phone calls for sure. It just happens in other places after that. Just
it
so you're aware.
Very random.
Yeah.
Okay, do we have a new question? We've got a few more minutes left before we get to our big reveal coming up at 6.
Hi, this is Gloria.
Go ahead, Gloria.
I have a 14 Pro, and when I tap the status bar, it says dynamic island, folder empty. I don't know what that is. I don't know what it's for, or what's the purpose of it, or what goes in it.
Okay, who can tell Gloria about the dynamic island? It's only on newer phones. I know that.
This is Sri.
Go ahead, Sri.
So, Gloria, I don't really fully understand the benefit for someone who's visually impaired that the dynamic island would provide any benefit, because a lot of that stuff that's in the dynamic island is visual. Obviously, if you touch it, VoiceOver will speak it. But basically what's in there is, like, for example, if you're playing a music, the music wave shows up in the dynamic island, so you can kind of have a visual look of the music. Or if you have a timer, it'll show up in the dynamic island.
This is Brad.
Oh, okay.
Go ahead, Brad.
Actually, if you're a VoiceOver, the dynamic island will show little icons of certain things that may be running at the time, such as Sri mentioned, music or a timer. But as a VoiceOver user, when you touch the dynamic island, you can then swipe left or right, and it'll tell you what those things are. When you land on one, if you double tap, the dynamic island expands, and there are controls for that item that will appear, just as they do for you know, a non-VoiceOver user. But when you have VoiceOver running, VoiceOver will help you access those controls, just like VoiceOver will access any other control. So it's really pretty neat. It first showed up in the iPhone 14 Pro and Pro Max phones, and it now has been expanded to all of the iPhone 15 phones. So all models have it. It's a new thing. It's, you know, it's something that's new. We all have to learn. What is this for and how will it help me? But it is accessible with VoiceOver.
Oh, okay. Thank you.
This is Greg.
Go ahead, Greg.
So we had a bad storm here last night and it knocked our, we have cable, you know, hardwired into the house, and the cable went out. So we didn't have any internet. And I wanted to search for something, so I thought I could just use Safari and use the cell data to do a search, but it was telling me that, I was not able to do it. It was saying that the, I forget what, was not available. Is there, so if internet is out or if I'm in a place where I can't get internet and I'm using cell data, do I need to turn Wi-Fi off or can I just, will it just automatically default to using cell data for a Safari search?
This is Herbie.
Go ahead, Herbie.
So yes, if you have no Wi-Fi, it's automatically going to connect to cell data, just like, you know, when you leave your house. Now, if you're in a situation where you have an active Wi-Fi network, but it has no internet connection, and so if you were to connect to it, you'd get nothing, then I would recommend you turn Wi-Fi off, and you'll want to do that in the actual Wi-Fi settings, not in the control panel, because that only temporarily turns it off. But otherwise, yeah, if there's no Wi-Fi, it just automatically switches over to the cell data.
All right, thank you.
This is Shree.
Hey, Shree.
Quick, just out of curiosity, is it possible that the power also went out? That's why you can connect?
This is Greg. No, power was on.
No, I said the tower, the cell tower.
Oh, the tower. That, oh, that could be. It, I'm trying to think what it was saying. I think it was saying the server not found.
This is Brad.
Hey, Brad.
Yeah, I think what Herbie said, see, your internet went out, but the modem that you have in your house, be it one from your internet provider or one that you've bought, either way, your Wi-Fi in the house is still broadcasting a Wi-Fi signal. You are connected to your Wi-Fi, but there's no internet that it's connected to because your internet service has gone out. And so that's like what Herbie's talking about. You need to go into settings and Wi-Fi and just turn Wi-Fi off so it won't even be looking for any Wi-Fi, because the one in your house, it's, you know, it says, they say it's on, you know, lights are on but nobody's home, it's on but there's no internet service. So if you just turn off Wi-Fi, you should have no problem connecting to your cellular data.
All right, good, thank you.
Okay. Do you have another question?
This is Sandhya.
We've only got 1 minute. I think we better hold off. It's just about time for Michael to come in with the big reveal, so we'll know what Friday night's movie is going to be.
All right. Thank you, Marie. Thank you very much. So what we'll do now is going to just give anybody who didn't get to say hello the first time around, just say who you are, where you're from.
This is Terry from Arlington Heights, Illinois.
Welcome.
Don from Houston.
Welcome.
This is Kathy from Tulsa. I don't want to be ungrateful, but it's time for a good movie.
Hey, Kathy, welcome.
Helene from Woodstock.
Hey, Helene, welcome.
Thank you.
Gloria.
Gloria and Sarah, welcome.
David from Houston.
Hey, David.
Brian from Ontario.
Welcome, Brian. Anybody else?
Hi, Vanessa, Georgia.
Hey, Vanessa, welcome. And who else?
Nate from
Nate, Maryland. Welcome, Nate. Yep.
Thank you.
Anybody else?
Mark in Montreal. I don't know if I got heard the first hour, so
all
I wasn't sure.
Yeah, welcome. Yes. Right. Okay. Keep going. Anybody else? Okay. All right. So now we know we're going to talk about our movie, what we're going to be watching on Friday night. We do it every Friday. iBUG Night at the Virtual Movies starting at 8 Central Social Time at 7:15. We do Name That Tune and a little some silliness. And then after the movie, we have a discussion and trivia. All right. So we're going to have some clues. And then you guys are going to have an opportunity to guess what the movie is. So let's see. I'm a guy. Are you out there?
Buying bread from a man in Brussels. He was 6'4" and full of muscle. I said, do you speak my language?
Yes. She's here. Welcome. Good to see everybody again. It's been a whole week. I know you've missed me, and I am back to for your pleasure. All right, as Miss Sandhya said, we are getting ready to give some clues up for this week's movie. And before we do that, though, I was looking at this article, and it said, you know, $100,000 doesn't go as far as it used to. And it was comparing different cities, what the value, real value of $100,000 is. And not probably not surprisingly to most people, cities in the south and central part of the U.S., it goes a lot further. Those out on the right and left coasts, it goes less. Anybody can guess what the number one city where $100,000 goes the most? This takes into account inflation, taxes, and other things like that.
This is Shree.
Shree.
Is it Houston?
Not Houston. Close. Actually, it's Memphis. Memphis, Tennessee was number one, where $100,000 is real value of about $86,000. And as Shree said, actually, out of the top 10, seven of the top 10 cities are in the great state of Texas. The other three being, well, we already said, Memphis, Oklahoma City, and St. Louis. Guess which ones are the two worst?
This is Janet, Denver, Colorado.
Yeah, go ahead, Janet.
Denver, Colorado.
Denver, it's down there on the low end, but...
this is Richard.
The two worst. Richard, yes.
New York.
Yes, New York is the absolute worst, where it's only worth $34,000. And San Francisco being the other one where it's a little over $35,000. So if you want your money to go further, don't live in those two places. All right, let's move on. It is now time for Michael.
He'll be back in a minute.
All right.
We'll be alive.
Okay, let's do it. Okay, we got some rules here for the clues. You get one guess per clue, and you get you got to say your name. Don't just shout out the title of the movie. You must say your name and wait to be acknowledged. Okay, here we go. Clue number one. Our film this week takes place in a place where several iBUG members live. Takes place where several iBUG members live. All right.
This is Terry.
Terry.
Would that be Alcatraz?
Alcatraz. What a great guess. Yes, we have several iBUG members living in New York.
Oh, San Francisco.
New York? Alcatraz is in San Francisco.
Yes.
California. Yes, we have several members living there, too. Just checking to see if you guys are awake tonight. All right. Obviously, those aren't the right answer, or Alcatraz was not the correct movie, but we're going to move on unless someone else.
Oh, this is Desi.
Go ahead, Debbie.
Desi.
Sorry.
Apollo 14.
Apollo 14. Where does that take place?
Might be the wrong number.
I think you're thinking of Apollo 13.
Oh, that's what I meant. Sorry. I have an iPhone 14.
And right now, we have no members living out in space. There are a lot of members that are spaced out, but none. Good try, Desi.
I did mean 13, by the way.
This is Shree.
Yes, Sri.
Philadelphia.
Philadelphia is another great movie and another great place where we have a number of people living. But that's not the one we're having this week.
Gary.
Oh, Gary, first time player, I think.
Yeah, pretty much. Urban Cowboy.
Urban Cowboy, another great movie. And you actually got the right state where we're thinking about. Just to give another little clue in there.
Keep going.
All right, we're going to move on to clue number two.
John.
Okay, John.
RoboCop.
RoboCop. See, that puts
it was filmed in Houston. I don't know if it takes place.
Right, you are right. Parts of it were filmed in Houston. But that is not the movie we're watching either. Okay, clue number two. The film involves elements of a thriller and the chase, but is essentially a character study. The film involves elements of a thriller and the chase, but is essentially a character study.
Mark in Montreal.
Go ahead, Mark in Montreal.
Smokey and the Bandit.
Smokey and the Bandit. And now you've taken us out of Texas, I think. That was in... No, that was in parts of... Was it in Texas? I don't know. But that's not the right movie either. Good try. I thought it was
Ed. Easy.
Ed.
Bullet.
Bullet. Another great movie, but not what we're watching this week. I don't have my gun ready or I would have shut you down. Okay.
David.
It's David.
David, yes.
No Country for Old Men.
No Country for Old Men. That does take place in Texas. David is such a good guesser at these movies. But unfortunately, he is absolutely correct. Ding, 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 ding.
Wow. That's 2 weeks in a row.
No Country for Old Men. We are going to be watching this week. Came out in 2007. Winner of 4 Academy Awards, including Best Picture, Best Directors, and Best Something. Oh, Best Actor in a Supporting Role, and Best Screenplay. So that's going to be our movie this week. And it will be another good one, 2 hours and 2 minutes this Friday. So let's see.
David won last week, Michael.
He won last week also. No.
Wow.
Yes, yes he did. Yes. Yeah, he got it on the bonus round.
Go play the lottery, man.
All right. What's the exact title?
No Country for Old Men.
Thank you.
We're just 3 bases in a row, but I'm not counting. 3?
Keep going.
Oh, wow. Wow, that is so good. Maybe we can.
Johnny, do we have a special prize for our three-time winner?
Yes, a special prize. Yes, we have a 1977 Ford Granada.
iBUG video.
iBUG colors. So you have one more vehicle to go around Houston with. Okay, good job. Very good, Brad, David. All right, Mr. McCulloch, want to say goodnight?
I come from a la 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 la.
All right, thank you very much. So the movie is No Country for Old Men. And now we are going to have our iBUG Bite segment. And, well, here we go. It's a nice, simple gesture that we're going to be talking about today. It is how to get to the control panel. All right.
Speech on. Silent voicemail. Back button.
All right. So what we're doing here is the control panel is where you have various quick controls that you can get to. They're always there. So how do you get there? So you go to your status bar, which is where your clock is, battery level, other things like that.
Location tracking on, image, status bar item, send. Location tracking on, image, status bar, 8:13 p.m., status
so
bar
item. So I just, it's for good measure, just look for the time. And then what you do is you do three finger swipe up.
Control center, airplane mode, switch button, off.
So the first thing there is airplane mode. I'm not going to explain all of these different controls, but I'm just going to let you hear what they are.
Cellular data, switch button, on. Wi-Fi, row 1, switch button, on. Bluetooth, switch button, on. AirPlay audio, button. Media controls, iPhone, not playing. Previous track, play, next track, button. Lock rotation, switch button, on.
That's a good one. Locking rotation, sometimes you might, your phone might be doing crazy stuff. With voiceover, definitely want to have rotation locked.
Screen mirroring, button. Brightness, 21%. Adjust volume, 100%. Adjustable.
Can control your volume.
Selected. Focus. Do not disturb. Button.
I have do not disturb on.
Accessories and scenes you add in the home app will appear here. Open home. Home. But living room home pod. Off. Button. Flashlight. Switch button. Off.
Yeah, we've had that question about whether your flashlight is on or off. You can control that.
Flashlight brightness. Off. Adjust timer. Button.
Timer.
Adjustable. Calculator, button. Camera, button. Apple TV remote, button.
And Apple TV remote. So it's a real quick way to get to those different controls. And you can, you know, go through what you need to. If you need to quickly turn off airplane mode or whatever, you can get there by, like I said, three finger swipe up.
Speech off.
Okay, that's a very simple demo. Now, all right, any questions?
This is Ed.
Go ahead, Ed.
Can you change, can you choose what controls you have in there? Like take some out or put some in?
Leave it alone. I was wondering about that. I don't think so. Go, Pete.
If you go into your settings and go into control center, which is what it's really called, there's a list of items that can be added to the control center. It also will list the items that are already included in your control center. So if you go to settings, control center, and go into that screen, Ed, you'll find a list of items that can be added to the control center.
All right. Thank you. All right. Anybody else?
Bridget.
Yes, Pam, go ahead.
Is Apple TV and Smart TV the same?
No. Apple TV is like a little box. It's kind of a misnomer. I mean, it's not an actual TV. It just gives you access to various applications and programs provided by Apple. But it is totally accessible.
This is Desi.
Go ahead.
About the control center thing, I know that at some places it says to open the control center, swipe down from the upper right-hand corner of your phone, at least with my iPhone 14 Pro, it does. And I, since iOS 17 have not been able to get that to work. I hear all the little pops and it just won't do it.
Yeah, I'm glad you said that, because I know that you should be able to do those gestures, and I also have 17 and I wasn't able to do that, but in preparing.
Oh, good. I was so glad to know there's an alternate way, because I was thinking, well, that's ridiculous, but no, it would not work.
This is Ed.
Go ahead, Ed.
I believe you can turn those corner swipes on and off. There's one for the upper left and one for the upper right in settings. I can't remember where you have to go. But I do have another question, is how do you get out of the control panel once you've got it open?
This is Shree.
Go ahead, Shree.
Yeah, you can scrub it.
Do a two-finger scrub. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
Go ahead.
Or you can swipe one finger up from the bottom of the screen and swipe up. Like you're closing an app, it'll close your control center as well.
Okay, more than one way to accomplish the task. All right, anybody else?
This is Shree.
Okay, Shree, go ahead.
Yeah, I was just going to say, you know, I just heard someone mention about swiping from the corner going to the control center. Yeah, I've never done it from the side of the phone. I've always done it straight, coming from the middle of the screen, coming down. I don't know if it really matters as a voiceover user, at least in my experience, how you do it, as long as you slide it from the top coming down until you hear the second pop.
Okay.
This is Pete.
Yeah, Pete.
I just want to say, I think you're right, Shree, but a lot of people that I've spoken, not a lot, but a handful, have say they use the right edge. They swipe down and use the right edge as kind of a guide, just so it go straight.
This is Desi.
Go ahead, Desi.
Yeah, I tried it. I honestly tried that in every position I could think of last night when I was trying to do it, because when it wasn't happened from the right corner, then I went to the middle and tried it. I could get all the little blips, but nothing would happen. So anyway, just to let you know.
Do your three straight.
All right, thank you. Go ahead, Shree, and then we'll move on.
Desi, you might want to just reboot your phone, because that should work. I mean, I just tried it on mine and it worked. I've never had it not work. So I would just try and reboot and see if it fixes the problem.
Okay. All right. Final question, then we'll move on. Okay, thank you, guys.
This is Marty.
Go ahead, Marty.
Does anyone know the mute button or new mute button that's on the 15 Pro, I guess, and Pro Max? They say it's a multi-function button. Does anyone know specifically what functions? And would that help with, like, voiceover? In other words, could we take one of our commands, say, like, you know, go to app switcher or something like that, and have that button do that function?
Anybody have a 15 or know about it?
This is Shree.
Oh, Shree.
So I do have one, but I don't recall. I remember reading that it's got like 9 different action items you can program that you can pick from. I don't recall seeing, you know, like turning voiceover on or off. It might be there. I just don't recall remember reading it. But
This is Marty. I'm not talking about turning voiceover on or off, but say, like, is one of the 9 actions like go to home or go to, in other words, could it replace, like, say, go to app switcher or go to home? Could it replace any of the gestures?
That? This is Shree. I will look at it, and if we have time later on, I'll give you the answer. I'll go look at it now.
Thank you.
Okay.
Thanks. All right. Who else? New question.
This is Helene.
Go ahead, Helene.
Facebook today, when I went into the just flicking my finger up, I have an SE3 2022 going to the next whatever was coming up. And several of the entries just had music. And I mean, most of Facebook lately seems to be advertisements, but it was crazy. BMW, and then there's music and
yes.
Something else. Is this something that came with the 16.7 or something? Because I didn't put 17 on, but all of a sudden, a lot of these things have music, and the only way I can get it to go away was to, you know, reboot the phone.
All right, this is Sandhya. I'll take that one because I have had the same. It's kind of startling because you're just like, you know, going along and looking at your notifications, and then starts like some really loud advertisements or videos that people posted. So we kind of talked about this before. I think we think it's like a new, you know, Facebook is making it. I think that sighted people have to deal with this already. It just automatically loads. I think that's what we determined. And so now we have the pleasure of being bombarded by the ads automatically without having to open them. Wow. Anybody else? Yeah, don't like it at all. But
and you can't get rid of it, right?
Well, you can just swipe to the next notification and you'll get out of it. Yeah, but it's kind of frustrating because you can't even hear what the post is because it's so loud. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yes, ma'am.
Right.
All right. Great question. Who else? New question?
Terry? Oh,
go ahead, Terry.
I currently have an iPhone SE 2020, and I'm considering updating my phone to something else. But I like the size of the SE 2020, and I won't care if the phone I upgrade to has a home button or not. So is besides the SE 2022, is there another phone that is of a similar or the same size as the SE 2020? Like I've heard about a couple of minis, you know, was it an iPhone 13 mini or something? Are any of those of similar size?
This All is right.
D. Go ahead, D.
Okay, yeah, the 12 and 13 mini are pretty much the same size as the SEs. Okay. Why Apple decided they went all this big deal to go make minis and only did it 2 years, and that is a very frustrating because I hate those big phones. I love my mini.
All right.
Thank you.
Thank you, D. Anybody else? New question? Got a few minutes. Nobody else? Question? Somebody who hasn't had a turn?
This is Jake.
Go ahead, Jake.
In regards to Cherry, what about the iPhone? What about the Pro model? Is that too big?
Cherry Ann, have you looked at the Pro models as opposed to the Pro Max? So,
this is Terry.
Go ahead.
I haven't looked at them. I probably need to go to some place where I can, you know, examine them to your point so that I kind of have a better idea. But it is good to know about the minis.
Right. This I think the 13s are going to be on their way out. So you got to go ahead and hurry up if you want to get one of them. Go ahead, D.
Yeah. Anything above the mini is going to be bigger than your SE.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Did I hear somebody Jody? Else? Go ahead, Jody.
15, just anything.
Yeah, I think, you know, the one that you have, Terry, is the same one I have. That's running an 11 processor, and then the SE. The SE3 from 2022, that's running the iPhone 13 processor. So if you updated to an SE3, then you'd still be running a 13 instead of an 11. But I don't really feel the need to upgrade.
They might actually come up with an SE24 this year. or SE4.
Oh, that'd be great.
They usually say, last year they did it in like March, I think, of last year. They didn't do it the same time when they did the 14, I don't think.
This is Jody. I heard they weren't going to have any more SEs, but I hope they do.
Okay. Anybody else? Final thought? We're going to get ready to do our iToys segment.
All right. So, everybody, welcome to the iToys segment for September, whatever it is, whatever year this is, 25th, 2023. And here at iBUG Today, we are all about giving everybody opportunities to grow and expand. And I am super excited tonight for our iToys segment to introduce a brand new iBUG member. And she's recently been a mentee, as a matter of fact. And tonight she's going to talk to us about the Rivo 2, which is an iPhone remote. And so, ladies and gentlemen, please clap your hands while muted, of course, for Rosetta Brown.
Thank you. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can.
Okay. Good evening, everyone.
Brown, I will be presenting the recent access of a nifty little device known as the Rivo 2. The Rivo is a wireless Bluetooth device or keypad that is designed to work with VoiceOver. It assists blind and visually impaired people to be able to easier make use of iPhones, iPods, also the Androids, and the tablets. The Rivo supports typing in 27 different languages. It weighs approximately 55 grams. It is sold by Mobius from South Korea. The company is called RIVO Inc. You may purchase this device via PayPal by going to the Rivo.me website and clicking on the PayPal link. The Rivo 2 is sold right now for $329 and can be shipped worldwide. The Rivo 3 is $799 and it also can be shipped worldwide. The website is Rivo.me. The email is info@rivo.net. The manuals are found on the Rivo.me website. A few years ago, Scott, Dabbert, did a podcast on the Rivo 2, and it was on AppleVis. There have been three hardware versions of the Rivo released over the years, version 1, 2, and 3. And the version 3 hardware, Rivo has just recently made its debut on the market. The Rivo 2 allows you to use your smartphone quickly and safely and comfortably by pressing buttons. It allows you to type in a text. It allows you to make and receive phone calls. It can work smoothly and switch between 6 different devices. It's very simple to use on the go. The smartphone is kept in your pocket, so you don't have to worry about taking it out and losing it. Most people have the Rivo around their neck on a lanyard. The thing that makes this even a more powerful device is that it can be used by people who are one-handed. In appearance, the Rivo looks something like this. There are 20 buttons, and they're arranged in 4 rows and 5 columns. The button 5 in the middle has the small dot on it. The microphone is on the front of the Rivo behind 3 small vertical holes. The speaker is on the right in a small hollow. There are 3 small buttons on the top of the Rivo. They are, from left to right, the power button, the keyboard button, and the audio button. On the bottom side, there is the place where the lanyard strap can be placed. There is also the charger port, the USB port for charging. And there's an earphone jack. The Rivo can be used in both vertical and horizontal mode. The horizontal mode is a default mode. Mode is in vertical mode, and usually that's the way most people use the Revo when they're making phone calls. The Revo 3 switches smoothly between up to 9 different devices, and this makes this an even more powerful device than the Revo 2. The Revo 3 can record voice and phone conversations, and this is something that the Revo 2 did not have. It can set the time and date, semicolon. you can feel the time through vibrations. Can be used as an MP3 player, and the Revo 2 did not have this aspect either. It can also be used as a calculator and a Braille dictionary. How exciting. It can be used as a timer or to check the date. So then we move on to charging the battery. The Revo has the battery charger, which comes with it, to plug into the USB charger port. If you want to know how long the Revo takes to charge, it is fully charged in approximately 3 hours. When Revo is plugged to charge, there's a vibration and the red light comes on, but when it is fully charged, the green light appears. Check the battery level, to check the battery level, press power plug forward. The number of short vibrations tell the battery level, and it can go up to 5. 5 means that the battery is full, fully charged. And when it gets down to 1, you need to get ready to put your Revo back on charge because it's about to go down on you. The quick nav setting on the iPhone needs to be turned on for the Revo or Revo to work properly. Press the 0 for the home button on the Revo. To activate Siri, hold down the 0 key for a second, and Siri will make a beep. If you want the app switcher, you press the 0 key twice quickly. In order to close the app switcher, you press 0. Now, that is my brief summary and synopsis of this wonderful small device known as the Revo. It has many other advanced features. However, I'm a novice, so if you have any questions, though, my mentor and expert on the Revo, Donald Turan, is possibly here, and he may be able to answer advanced questions. I'd like to thank you, Donald, for coming. I'd also like to thank my iBUG mentor, or rather mentee, Ms. Nancy Stevens. Thank you, Nancy. And my friends that have come, Rita Harris, Harvey Carter. I'd like to thank you all. Have a wonderful evening.
Hello?
All right. Did you have anything else to say before we take questions?
No, just that I appreciate you allowing me or giving me this opportunity to present, and I've been really nervous and my voice hasn't been very good today, but it's quite a pleasure and quite an honor. And maybe Donald is here. Donald, are you here?
Well, first of all, while we're looking for Donald, I just want to say you pulled it off with flying colors. It was not obvious that you were nervous. And people are relieved because they don't have to hear me talk. So believe me, you don't have anything to be nervous about. So
thank you. Thank you so much.
All right. So then let's go ahead and take questions then.
This is Nancy.
Yes, Nancy.
I just wanted to say, yay, Rosetta, you did a great job. But what I sort of missed what you would use this for. You can use it to type on your phone. What else do you use it for?
Well, the Revo can be used to...
Is this Donald?
Yes, it is.
Okay. Hi. Just a reminder to people, if you're going to say something, please announce yourself first so we know who you are. All right. Sorry, yes, go ahead.
Donald Durant, right here. Yes, you can use it to control your The main purpose is to control your iPhone in a precise manner, which would alleviate, you know, the swiping gestures and the, you know, double tapping. And it just makes the use of your iPhone more precise.
Excellent. And Rosetta, did you have anything you wanted to add before we move on? All right, I guess not. Hearing silence. Let's go on to our next question.
This is Terry.
Yes, Terry.
Rosetta, you or Donald, you mentioned, Rosetta, you mentioned you referred to something on the Revo or Rival 3 as a Braille dictionary. And I'm just kind of curious, is that a feature that is separate from iPhone use? That's an extra perk with the 3?
Well, this is Donald. I'm not sure. They mentioned that in the description, but I'm not sure what that, you know, is all about, the Braille dictionary. But they do mention that in the description of the Revo 3.
Got it. Okay. Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
All right. Very good, Terry. And who is next?
This is Ed.
Okay, Pete, and then Ed.
I missed the price of the Revo 3. I think the 2 is, what, 3 something? And I didn't hear what she said the price of the new 3 was. Donald, do you know that?
Yes, the 2 is $329, and the Revo 3 is $799.
$799. That is a mage. And I think we're talking... $799 or $7.99, so just to be clear on this point.
I wish.
Yeah.
The decimal mark is past the 99 in both cases. Okay.
That's almost as much as your phone itself.
I was going to say, that is, you know, a phone or an Apple Watch, you know, new Apple Watch costs the same amount as the Revo 3. All right. Okay, Ed.
Yeah, what is the advantage of the Revo as opposed to a keyboard? I mean, there are small keyboard, foldable keyboards and stuff like that. So what is the actual advantage?
Well, the Revo is about the size of a credit card. Of course, you know, some of those portable keyboards are, you know, not as small as that. And she said, she described that it has like 20 buttons on it. It's 5 columns and 4 rows. On the left side is what they call the L1, L2, L3. It's like function, you know, buttons. And on the extreme right, you have R1. R2, R3, and R4. And in the middle of those two rows, you have the telephone style keypad.
So basically, like having kind of like a talking calculator keypad as opposed to an actual keyboard keypad. So that's going to mean some different commands and.
Right.
Things like that. But I'll tell you this much, in comparison to the size of the credit card, if I was to get one of these, it would be bigger than my credit card because I'd have no credit card after that. So, all right. Thank you, Ed. And we are running overtime here, so I think we've about covered everything. So, Sandhya, I'm going to hand it back to you. And Rosetta, great job. And we look forward to seeing you on the future iBUG events.
All right. Thank you, Herbie and Ms. Rosetta. Thank you very much. All right. So back to our regularly scheduled program. Who has a new question?
or even
this is Nancy.
Go ahead.
I wonder if anybody, I got my Apple Watch a couple of years ago, I think, and I still cannot get the haptic time to work on it. And has anybody had any luck with it? I have the Watch SE.
Anybody haptic time?
This is Terry.
Go Terry and then Deb.
I don't have an SE, but it works sometimes, and it's on again, off again kind of a thing with the haptic feature.
All right, Deb.
I have my watch is a 7, and if I while it's locked, you know, you haven't invoked it at all. If you just tap on it with one finger twice, it almost always will do that haptic time.
All right. Talking about haptic time on the Apple Watch, getting it to work consistently. Anybody else comment?
This is Greg.
Go, Greg.
Yeah, I use that a lot. And if you double tap on the watch face, then it will give you hours and minutes. And if you triple tap on the watch face, it just gives you minutes.
Oh, okay. All right. Thank you, Nancy. Good question. All right, moving on. Who else? New question.
This is Shri.
Oh, Shri.
So I did check on my phone on the action button. When it comes to voiceover settings, the only option is to turn voiceover on and off. There are lots of other options for accessibility that you can pick from, but for voiceovers, that's just it.
All right. Thank you.
This is Marty. Thanks. Go.
All right. Thank you. All right. Who else? New question.
This is Marty.
Oh, I think I forgot somebody. Okay. Go, Marty.
On the Apple Watch, I'm having trouble like just tapping to get the haptic. It seems like every time I double tap, whether I do a light double tap or a fast or slow double tap, I get the time. I don't seem to get the haptic anymore.
Right. We just talked about that with Nancy. So some people said it is working for them. So I'm not
and
sure.
What, are they doing anything specific that it's working for them, or it just works?
Just works, I think.
This is Terry.
Go ahead.
I happen to have an 8. I watch 8, and I find now if I tap anywhere on the screen, double tap, you'll get the haptic time. Sometimes the speech comes on, but most of the time now I've tried it for the past few minutes and it really is working better with the later models. And you double tap or triple tap with one finger anywhere on the screen, and in theory it should give you the haptic vibrations.
All right. Thank you, Terry Ann, for that summary. Go ahead, Sarah.
This is Mandy.
Go ahead.
I had just come across on my Series 6 that Taptic Time is not available when Speak Time is configured to always speak. So I don't know if that's turning Taptic Time off. It like I must have that turned on because it won't even turn Taptic Time on. I don't know if that's what you're dealing with, the Speak Time. It's okay. Configured to always speak. You can't use Taptic Time.
All right. Thank you, Mandy. That help. All right. Who else did I hear?
D. Yeah. Okay. On my Apple Watch, this is one thing I have trouble with. I know you're supposed to take two fingers and swipe up to get your control center. I have a heck of a time doing that. I swipe and swipe and swipe, and once in a great while, control center opens up. Am I anything special I should be doing different?
This is
Deb.
So Deb and then Marty. Deb.
On mine, again, it's a 7. I can access the control center by taking just by using one finger and swiping down from the top, and it'll kind of go through or cycle through like the control center, notification center, and now with the new update, it also shows widgets, which I'm not real familiar with, but and then a customized watch face. So that's how I've been doing that. And with this new update, it says you can access the control center by pushing the side button with a watch 10. Activity.
Hey.
So that might make that easier.
All right, we're hearing some voiceover, so gotta silence that. Okay, Marty.
I pretty much had the same answer, just one finger swipe. Is watch 10 available, or do you have to have iOS 17 to get watch OS 10?
Yeah, this is Deb.
Go ahead.
Yes, you do have to have watch 7. I mean, you have to have iOS 17 to get watch 10.
All right.
Thanks.
All right. Thank you, Deb. All right. Who else? New question. Well, that's a good, everybody participating. I like that. Okay. Who else? Well, I will tell a little. Go ahead, David.
I was wondering if anybody has found any new features on the watch OS 10 that are helpful. It seemed like a lot of it was visual in nature, like how the things look, you know, the little icons and the, they kind of did a major redesign of the look of it, but I don't know if, I know the other person mentioned widgets, which I wasn't aware of widgets on the watch. I mean, that's something I have never looked into, but if anyone has any cool feature, they think it's cool.
All right, anybody? OS 10, watch OS 10 features. Okay.
This is Terry.
Go ahead.
I haven't heard anything of any particular significance that just jumped out at me for a Siri for. Watch OS 10, and I haven't heard anything in particular of any significance regarding the Watch Series 9 that I'm not sure if it's out yet or it's soon to be out.
Okay,
so we're talking about the watch itself, the hardware that's the Series 9, and then we're also talking about the update if you have iOS 17. That you can then go to watch OS 10. So it's a little confusing, but I didn't hear of anything in particular for either one.
Okay, thank you, Terry Ann.
This is Shree.
Go, Shree.
I think the only thing that I heard from any meaning on the watch was the double pinch, which voiceover user on the watch, we could do it before. But I didn't hear anything from an accessibility, anything really new.
Okay. All right. Thanks, Shree.
This is Greg.
Go, Greg.
Yeah. Once a new feature on iOS 17 was name drop, where you can exchange contact information, and you can do that with either the phone holding phones close together, or you can do that with your watch.
Okay. All right. Thank you, Greg. All right, anybody else?
This is Shree.
Go ahead.
I have a question. So my wife got the new phone, and she was trying to merge her contacts from her old phone, which had somewhere around 400 contacts. But on her new phone, when she set up contact to sync up, only like 200 and some contacts showed up. And even though that she looked at her old phone with some new contact that she created, it's there, but it didn't show up on the new phone. Is there something that needs to be done to sync it all up?
That's a loaded question. Anybody have a quick answer?
for Shree.
This is Marty.
Go ahead.
Did she try Shree doing the contacts from the backup?
She pulled, I turned contacts off from iCloud so it stayed locally on the phone just to see if that would trigger the sync, but that didn't do anything, if that's what you're referring to.
Yeah, that's what I was referring to, the iCloud backup.
All right, anybody else? All right, Shree, we're going to have to.
I guess it's not my problem.
This is Mandy.
Go, Mandy.
Well, has she logged into her other accounts that she had connected to? like a Gmail? I ran into this a while back where I didn't realize I put an email account back on my phone that I didn't have before. Or no, that I had, but I had to reload it or something. And then contacts started getting saved to that. Now, it's not like with, there was something that you can pick which calendar you want to save stuff on, but you can't pick which account you want to save your contacts on, which I kind of wish that was a setting, because that has messed me up a few times. I didn't realize new contacts were going into a different account that I had recently added. So that this threw me off. Or you could just need to give it more time to sync.
This Marie,
go ahead.
Yeah, if you go into settings and go to accounts, it will show you what email accounts you have set up. And each one of them, if you go in there, you can enable or disable contacts for that email. So it could be that maybe she hasn't added an email account, or she hasn't gone into that setting and turned on contacts for that email.
All right. That'll have to be the final word on that question. Thank you, Marie, for helping to facilitate tonight. Thank you. And quick review of this week's events. We have tomorrow Clubhouse from 5 to 6, Mini Buzz. Then in the evening, the Mac and Talk call. Thursday is Taking Care of Business. It's iBug's Life. When Friday is the movie No Country for Old Men. And we're off this weekend, so be looking out for the iBug Apple workshop where we discuss the new features of iOS 17. And thank you, Herbie and Miss Rosetta, for the iToys segment. And with that, we will say good night.
Thanks, guys.
Good night.
Good night, John Boy.
Good night, everybody.
Good night.
Good night, everybody.